Welcome back to the Island 54 Devlog. Today, I'll finish up the work I was doing to make my game massively scalable. Last week, I built out most of the services I was going to need to make my game massively scalable. Today, I'll talk a bit about performance, show you how I made it easier to deploy my service using Docker, and how I changed the client to make use of the new server backend. The changes are going to look like a massive step back for now, with the terrain being flat and no trees, rocks, or mob spawning. This is because I didn't have time to port these features across to the backend. I'm going to plow ahead in this direction anyway, because it's now a lot faster and easier for me to try changes out in the backend. I'll port more of the existing features across to the backend as I work on other things over the next couple of episodes. Before I get into the changes for this week, I want to address a comment I received in a bit more detail. It's about performance. Juice points out that the old netcode is inefficient because I was putting the player transform into a dictionary. Juice goes on to say that an MMO needs every bit of performance possible. I want to break this down into a few different parts. Firstly, there's a general software engineering rule, which is often just said as don't prematurely optimize. This idea applies to any kind of development, whether you're working on a game, a desktop app, an embedded device, or a web service. The idea here is that you should never put any effort into optimizing code unless you can demonstrate it needs to be optimized. Optimizing code almost always leads to more software complexity and can constrain other design decisions down the line. This can make it more time consuming to maintain your code later and even degrade overall performance since you're more constrained in what other changes you can make. Secondly, the idea that garbage collection is a consideration here is pretty easy to debunk with a profiler. I've compared results from my profiler both with and without the netcode running, and there is just no significant difference between them. Once upon a time, garbage collectors were slow, without exception. They'd have to periodically scan your heap looking for unused allocations and cycles. Modern garbage collectors are what are called generational collectors. They do short, fast collection runs on recently allocated memory and promote allocations to older generations once they have hung around too long. The overhead on collections for temporary allocations like these are just not important in the scheme of things. More important than eking out every last bit of performance in the client netcode is optimizing the network packets and ensuring the server is scalable. So even though I'm moving away from using dictionaries and JSON in this week's episode, I'm avoiding using packed structs, as the commenter suggested, because I want it to be easier to optimize for what matters. My protocol is based on protobuf. It's relatively expensive to serialize transforms and things into protobuf, but I'll get a few advantages out of it. Firstly, my protocol is symmetrical. I only need to maintain a single protocol, whether it's the client sending data or the server sending data. Secondly, protobuf is easy to transmit through a compressed stream. So with hardly any development work, I can get more data into the UDP stream. I mentioned last week that I was manually bringing services up and down, which was slowing me down a lot. I wanted a more reliable way of deploying my services, so I set up Docker Compose. I started with a very basic Docker file. It just pulls in the public node image, makes sure that some packages we need are installed, and nothing else. This will be used by each of the microservices. I then wrote a Docker Compose spec with a few services defined. Session cache just tells Docker to spin up a Redis instance for the session management service. The session service uses the Docker file I defined earlier. It mounts the entire source path in /app and uses yarn to spin up the session service. Doing it like this makes it really easy to hook in the debugger and have it automatically reload changes as I change the code. The spec configures the service to connect to Redis over Docker's overlay network. Each of these services gets its own private IP address so they can talk to each other. The port for the session service gets exposed so that local clients can talk to it through the host network. The entity service and its MongoDB store are set up in almost exactly the same way. The UDP receiver and transmitter services are similar again, but need to be told how to connect to each of the session and entity services. The UDP receiver also needs to expose both its TCP and UDP port to the host machine. And lastly, I wrote a terrain generation service. It's not particularly full-featured yet, and only returns a flat world. I'll get the actual terrain generation code ported across here soon. Running the server is now as simple as running a single Docker command, docker compose up. This goes and starts all of the required Redis, Mongo, and Node processes that make up the current server. It gets some errors as it comes up, since some services can come up before their dependencies have started, but everything comes up cleanly after a couple of seconds. Adding more services is as simple as writing the new service and adding a new entry to the Docker compose file. That brings us to the client-side code. I changed the chunk stream code so that instead of calling the terrain generator, it fetches the chunks from the terrain service. There's no need for terrain data to come in over UDP, so I just made these requests directly to the terrain service over HTTP. It just gets height data back from the server, which it uses to populate the hoxels within a chunk. Once the terrain can be modified by players, the server will need to be able to send more than just height data back, but I'll get to that another time. I updated the client to use the new protocol. For now, I manually compile the protobuf spec into a C# class. I'd rather this be automated as part of my compile process, but I just didn't get around to working out how to do that. I modified my code to support the new protocol I defined last week. Each packet gets a control word, a session ID, a hash, and then the protobuf payload. The packets still aren't being compressed or encrypted, but I'll be adding that before the service goes live in the cloud. Each time a packet is received from the service, we check the hash and decode the payload before updating local copies of any entities the server wants to tell us about. So with the terrain and scatter generation code not properly ported across to the server, there's unfortunately not much to demo this week. It really does feel like I've taken two steps forward and one step back in my quest to test this out as an MMO. But I have enough of the infrastructure up that I can start making proper code changes on the server now. While that's all I had time for this episode, I will continue porting the terrain generation and scatter code over in the background. But I need a bit of a break from the networking side of things for now. So next week, I intend to work on something else, probably working towards getting aggressive mobs into the game so that I can start playing with the combat system. Let me know either in the comments below or over on Discord if there's anything you want me to focus on soon. There's an invite to the Discord server down in the description below. And until next time, happy game developing.